Okay, folks, it's 10 o'clock, probably about time to get rolling here.
Rangers,
like
you
to call
break it up.
To order the November meeting of the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District. Kim, would you please call the roll?
Barrett.
Yes.
Kavanaugh.
Yes, or here.
Here. Mines.
Here.
Ulrich.
Here.
Agenda item number 2, announcement regarding public notice of meeting. Notice of the time and place of this meeting was publicized by notifying the area news media by publicizing same in the Omaha World Herald and outlets by displaying such notice on the arcade level of Energy Plaza since November 7, 2014, and by mailing such notice to each of the district's directors on that same date. A copy of the proposed agenda for this meeting has been maintained on a current basis and is readily available for public inspection in the office of the district's corporate secretary. Additionally, a copy of the open meetings law is available for inspection in the public meeting book located in this meeting room. Agenda item number 3, approval of the September 2014 comprehensive financial and operating reports and of the October 16th, 2014 minutes for the last meeting.
Folks, we need a motion and a second.
So move.
Second.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Agenda item number 4, persons wishing to address the Board of Directors on a particular item are asked to approach the microphone as that agenda item is discussed. Comments will be heard following Board discussion of the item and prior to a vote by the Board. Persons wishing to address the Board on all other matters will have an opportunity before the close of the meeting. Agenda item number 5A, motion to dispense with the reading of resolution number 6017.
Go ahead.
Be it resolved because a copy of resolution number 6017 has been furnished to each director in advance of this meeting, the reading in full of the resolution in this meeting by the secretary be dispensed with, except for those portions of the resolution which have been materially revised and the additions necessary to complete said resolution.
So moved.
For a second.
Second.
A motion and a second. Kim, please call the roll.
Barrett.
Yes.
Kavanaugh.
Yes.
Gay.
Yes.
Green.
Yes.
McGuire.
Yes.
Mines.
Yes.
Ulrich.
Yes.
Okay, changes to resolution number 6017. We call Mr. Petter from our bond council.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I'm John Petter with the law firm of Keetack Rock, bond counsel to the district. Pleased to be here, and I can inform you there have been no changes to resolution number 6017.
Thank you. Yep.
Resolution number 6017 authorizes the creation and the issuance of the Electric System Revenue Bonds 2014-2015 series.
Okay, you need a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second. Or is there any discussion on this? John, do you want to?
I do. The district issues senior lien electric system revenue bonds, which is what we're talking about, to fund a portion of the capital program. Management believes that tax-exempt interest rates remain in acceptable levels, or if the district's liquidity is projected to decrease below acceptable levels, that it may be advantageous for the district to refund some of the existing senior liens and or fund a portion of the capital program as outlined. The district financial advisor, Barclays Capital, has indicated that pursuing a refunding transaction in the current market is a reasonable strategy to capitalize on current market rates. Resolution number 6017 authorizes the creation and issuance of one or more series of 2014-2015 senior lien electric system revenue bonds. The bonds will be traditional tax-exempt bonds. Resolution 6018, which is next, authorizes management to negotiate investment banking agreements with local and national investment banks in order to sell the bonds authorized under the previous resolution. Resolution 618 also approves the official statement and provides authority for the president and the chief financial officer to execute one or more of the pricing certificates and bond purchase agreements for the 2014-2015 series bonds through December 31, 2015. In an aggregate principal amount not to exceed $475 million. $375 million for refunding purposes, and $100 million to fund new capital. Dates may be extended by this board for further action sometime in the future. The authority allows us to sell bonds to be sold when acceptable market conditions exist, regardless of the timing of regularly scheduled board meetings. So instead of negotiating and coming back to a board meeting at one time, we set these systems up so that management can take advantage of the opportunity as it exists and then report back to the board for approval. And the board will receive quarterly updates on the status of these bonds. Final pricing of the series of the bonds will be presented at the next regularly scheduled board meeting immediately following the execution of the bond agreement. And these bonds have been reviewed by both Moody's and Standard & Poor's. And on Moody's, we've received a AA3 rating. And then Standard & Poor's, we've received a AA rating.
Okay, before we call on our attorneys, does any board members have any comments at this point?
Okay. I have one question for Edward Eastland. What's the repayment schedule on this? And this would be like the very nuts and bolts of bonds.
We have bonds outstanding today that we're looking to refund, and those bonds extend out from the date of issuance approximately 30 years. And so as we're getting close to 9 or 10 years left, into that bond issue, we'll have another 22 years left. So what we'll do is the refunding will match that repayment schedule. We won't extend it beyond the original maturity dates. And the interest savings will then be reflected in those payments that we'll make into the future, and it'll be less than what we would have made on the original bonds.
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to call Mr. Petter again.
Thank you again. I can confirm that the bond issuance of the district's bonds in accordance with Resolution 6017, QTAC ROC will be able to deliver its opinion that the bonds are legally and validly issued and enforceable against the district, and that interest on the bonds is exempt from federal and state income taxation. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to call on Mr. Bruckner, our general counsel.
Good morning, Chairman Cavanaugh, members of the board. As general counsel for the district, we've examined the proposed series resolution, which is designated and before you as resolution number 6017 for the 2014 or 2015 series bonds. In our opinion, the board of directors of the district may legally adopt that series resolution number 6017 and authorize the issuance of the bonds in an amount not to exceed $475 million. With the authorization being granted by the board through and including the December 31, 2015, and after that being of no force and effect. And I will leave the original of our opinion with the corporate secretary. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Kim, would you call the roll on resolution number 6017?
Barrett.
Yes.
Kavanaugh.
Yes.
Gay.
Yes.
Green.
Yes.
McGuire.
Yes.
Mines.
Yes.
Ulrich.
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 5B, motion to dispense with reading of resolution number 6018 and preliminary official statement. Be it resolved that because of a copy of resolution number 6018 and the preliminary official statement incident to the 2014-2015 series bonds have been furnished to each director in advance of this meeting, the reading in full of the resolution and the preliminary official statement in this meeting by the secretary be dispensed with except for those portions of the resolution and preliminary official statement which have been materially revised and the additions necessary to complete said resolution and the preliminary official statement.
Okay, we need a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second to dispense with the reading. Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Okay, we'll call on Mr. Petter again.
Thank you again. I can report to you that there have been no changes to either resolution number 6018 or to the preliminary official statement that you previously received.
Thank you. Kim?
Resolution number 6018 approves the official statement and provides authority for the President and Chief Executive Officer or the Vice President and Chief Financial Officer to execute one or more investment banking agreements, pricing certificates, and bond purchase agreements for the 2014-2015 series bonds through December 31st, 2015, as such date may be extended by further action of the Board. This authority would allow the bonds to be sold when acceptable market conditions exist, regardless of the timing of regularly scheduled board meetings.
So moved.
Is there a second, please?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. John?
As I already said, as we discussed Resolution 6017, this is a companion piece which authorizes the approval of the official statement and allows management to go ahead and sell the property. Any further pricings will be reported back to us at a later date.
Now we need the opinion of our general counsel, Mr. Brucker.
Members of the board, as general counsel, we have examined the form of the bond purchase agreement for the purchase of the series bonds that we've been discussing here. And we also have examined the form of the preliminary official statement for use in connection with those bonds. We also have reviewed the form of resolution number 6018, which is before the board right now. And in our opinion, the board of directors may legally adopt resolution number 6018, which would authorize the president and chief executive officer or vice president and chief financial officer of the district to execute and deliver one or more pricing certificates, bond purchase agreements, and official statements for the 2014 or 2015 series bonds through and including December 31, 2015. And I will also leave the original of our opinion with the corporate secretary.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Kim, could you call the roll?
John.
Oh, excuse me.
John
Pollock. I'm sorry. You're going to come back. Nice job Tuesday morning, John.
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street, Omaha. I have a couple of questions here. The issues of bonds that are being recalled now, and obviously were callable bonds. I'm wondering if these new replacement bonds will also be callable, and if they are, what's the approximate difference in market rate between a callable bond and a fixed bond that just goes to maturity? Can anybody tell me that?
The bonds will have a call feature very similar to the bonds that we're refunding, which is approximately a 10-year call. Depending on market conditions, sometimes the call is a little bit less. If we can get a shorter call without a penalty in the market, we will pursue a shorter call. So some of them are actually 9 years as opposed to 10 years. Very seldom do we go less than that. There is one type of bond that we actually used in our last bond deal that's called a step coupon bond that has a 5-year call on it. And it kind of depends on what the market is willing to price for you. And that also influences the value or the price of the call. I'm going to ask John Thurber, our finance director, if he has a feel for what the current price for a call is.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Edward. It depends on where we're looking at it in the marketplace, but I would say roughly about 10, 15 basis points would be about the savings that we would have by having a call versus not having a call on the bonds.
Thank you.
Good question, John.
I would answer that question, but there are very few opportunities I get to use my master's in finance.
Just for Director Cavanaugh, or Chairman Cavanaugh, what is the estimated savings? I think we ought to at least announce that as for the general public. How much money are we saving by doing this? We're not just doing this to entertain our councils.
I'll give an example of our previous refunding that we just got. As far as savings, maybe that would be easier because you don't know what you're going to get with this.
Thank you, because my crystal ball is a little cloudy at the moment.
Can't tell,
I guess that's what I meant.
I would say, given today's interest rates, we're looking right now at the possibility of refunding about $125 million revenue bonds. Our target on that is we have to save more than 5% in order to pursue the transaction. So we have $125 million today that is in excess of 5%. As far as the dollar amount goes, Earlier this year, we had two transactions, two refundings. Between those transactions, we refunded $30 million of bonds. They were our subordinate bonds. And the savings on those two transactions were $30 million, present value.
Think so.
That was about 9, almost 10% of the outstanding par amount.
Significant savings. Yeah. Okay. Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 6A, motion to dispense with reading of resolution number 6019. Be it resolved that because a copy of resolution number 6019 has been furnished to each director in advance of this meeting, the reading in full of the resolution in this meeting by the secretary be dispensed with, except for those portions of the resolution which have been materially revised and the additions necessary to complete said resolution.
We need a motion, a second, to dispense with the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Motion, a second. I'd like to call upon.
Take a vote.
Kim.
Secretary Kim to conduct the roll. Kim, could you call the roll? I'm sorry.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
It was worded a little differently. Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, now to address the changes to the resolution number 6019, Mr. Petter, you have a comment?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There have been no changes to resolution 6019. Thank you.
Kim?
Resolution number 6019 authorizes the creation and issuance of the separate electric system revenue bonds, Nebraska City 2, 2014-2015 series.
Okay, you have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second, John?
The district issues separate system bonds during the construction of Nebraska City Station number 2 on behalf of our partners in that facility. Management believes that if the tax-exempt interest rates remain at acceptable levels, it may be advantageous for the district to refund existing Nebraska City 2 separate electric system debt. The district's financial advisors, Barclays, has indicated that pursuing a refunding transaction in the current market rates is a reasonable strategy to capitalize on current market interest rates. Resolution 6019 authorizes the creation and issuance of one or more series 2014-2015 separate electric system revenue bonds, Nebraska City 2. The bonds will be traditional tax-exempt bonds. Resolution 6020 authorizes management to negotiate investment banking agreements with the local and national investment banks in order to sell the bonds authorized under the previous resolution. Resolution 6020 also approves the official statement and approves authority for the President and Chief Financial Officer to execute one or more pricing certificates and bond purchase agreements for the 2014-2015 series bonds through December 31, 2015 in an aggregate principal amount not to exceed $250 million. The date may be extended by further board action. This authority would allow the bonds to be sold when acceptable market conditions exist, regardless of the timing of the regularly scheduled board meetings. A written opinion of the district's financial advisor will certify to the board that the terms for the 2014-2015 series bonds reflect rates competitive with the current market conditions. This board will receive quarterly updates on the status of the bonds. Final pricing of the series of bonds will be presented at the next regularly scheduled board meeting immediately following the execution of the bond purchase agreement.
Thank you. Mr. Petter.
Great, this may sound a little repetitive, but with respect to these bonds as well, upon issuance of the separate system bonds in accordance with Resolution 6019, we'll be able to deliver our opinion that the bonds are legally and validly issued, enforceable against the district, and that interest on the bonds is exempt from federal and state taxes.
Thank you. Mr. Brucker.
We're both getting our exercise this morning. As general counsel for the district, we have examined the proposed series bond resolution that is designated as resolution number 6019 for the issuance of the separate electric system revenue refunding bonds for Nebraska City 2. And in our opinion, the Board of Directors may legally adopt that resolution and authorize the issuance of those bonds in an aggregate amount up to $250 million, with that authorization being granted through December 31, 2015. And I have a copy, or rather the original of our opinion for the corporate secretary.
Mr. Buckner, I have a question related to this. This is for our participants, the Nebraska City 2 participants. Is this actually, any economic benefit goes to the participants and not
That's correct. The
OPPD district.
Correct.
Can you tell me exactly how the participants participate in this afterwards? After we pass this, do their boards go back and vote on this also, or how does that work?
All of the authorizations, I believe, have been or will be obtained before closing, and I believe that's how it works. John Petter is signifying yes, so you're typically more involved in that than I am, but I think that's the process that will be followed. They'll go through and authorize this, and they provided all of the necessary information to be included in the official statement at this point, I believe, and then we'll go forward and close the bonds.
And the actual cost for this, do the participants pay for this in the end?
Yes, they do.
And we do not. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
Okay, Kim, could we, if there's no other comments or questions, Kim, would you call the roll, please?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 6B, motion to dispense with reading of resolution number 6020 and preliminary official statement. Be it resolved that because a copy of the resolution number 6020 and the preliminary official statement incident to the 2014-2015 series bonds has been furnished to each director in advance of this meeting, the reading in full of the resolution and the preliminary official statement in this meeting by the secretary be dispensed with, except for those portions of the resolution and preliminary official statement which have been materially revised and the additions necessary to complete said resolution and the preliminary official statement.
Motion second to reading.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. Kim.
Barrett.
Yes.
Kavanaugh.
Yes.
Gay.
Yes.
Green.
Yes.
McGuire.
Yes.
Mines.
Yes.
Ulrich.
Yes.
Okay, I would like to call upon Mr. Petter to discuss any changes to resolution number 6020 concerning the preliminary official statement.
Thank you once again, and I can confirm there have been no changes to Resolution 6020, nor have there been any to the preliminary official statement.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kim?
Resolution number 6020 approves the official statement and provides authority for the President and Chief Executive Officer or the Vice President and Chief Financial Officer to execute one or more investment banking agreements, pricing certificates, and bond purchase agreements for the 2014-2015 series bonds through December 31st, 2015, as such date may be extended by further action of the board. This authority would allow the bonds to be sold when acceptable market conditions exist, regardless of the timing of regularly scheduled board meetings.
You need a motion and a second to approve the resolution.
So moved.
Second.
Second. John.
Continuing on what I said earlier, that this is the second resolution and this approves the official statement and provides the authority to go forward with the bond sale as indicated.
Okay. Mr. Brecker, I'm calling you for the general counsel opinion.
Thank you, Chairman Kavanaugh. As general counsel, we have examined the form of the bond purchase agreement for the separate electric system revenue refunding bonds that we've been discussing here, and also the form of the preliminary official statement for those bonds. We also have reviewed the form of resolution number 6020, and it is our opinion that the board may legally adopt resolution number 6020, and that resolution would authorize the president and chief executive officer for the Vice President and Chief Financial Officer of the District to execute and deliver one or more pricing certificates, bond purchase agreements, and official statements for the separate system bonds through and including December 31, 2015.
Thank you. Kim, can we call the roll call on approval of resolution number 6020?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Before we move on, Mr. Chairman. You wonder why we waive the reading at the board meeting?
Yeah.
This is Resolution 6020. That's just one of the four resolutions.
Item number 7, Resolution number 6021. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the proposal of Southwire Company LLC of RFP number 4439 in the amount of $4,055,068.80 for the purchase of twisted pair ACSR conductor wire be and hereby is accepted and approved.
So moved.
Your second, please.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. John, you're handling it.
Thank you. In the absence of Director Weber, rather than simply hogging my mic here today,
you know, you did that anyway.
This and the next resolution go to the new line, which is going to be completed to Marysville, Missouri, as part of the Southwest Power Pool improvement in reliability throughout the system.
In addition,
there's a line that will run from Brock, Nebraska back to the Cooper Station, which will assist in this. And so last two meetings ago, we discussed the purchase of easements. Last meeting for this line, we purchased the poles. Resolution number 621 is for the conductor wire which goes along with this project. And the next resolution is for insulators and hardware. We had 6 proposals from 5 vendors. 5 proposals were legally responsive. The proposal of Southwire is technically acceptable. Some of the others were not. The engineer's estimate on this project was about $3.8 million. And Southwire Company, LLC, is to be awarded the contract in the amount of $4,055,068.80.
Okay. Any other comments from board members?
It's some of the other people who bid, their numbers were lower, their costs were lower, but we were unable to evaluate past performance, and that's why we did not. So even though they had lower bids, since we couldn't really verify that their performance was good or bad, can you explain about that?
Director McGuire, yeah, that is correct. The lowest 3 proposals were not technically responsive. The first one was proposing to bring a company from India to do this job and providing the wire. And we could not verify any references, so OPPD would have been the first company in the USA to use this company. And from risk management perspective, we did not feel that that's acceptable to OPPD. The second lowest company was proposing to bring a company from China to provide the conductor wire. And that would have put OPPD to be the first to use this company worldwide, not only in the U.S., so we did not feel comfortable at all. The third one was under a non-disclosure agreement, so we couldn't get any information whatsoever on it. So based on those 3 reasons, we've decided to, in the best interest of OPPD and our customers, to go
by USA.
Absolutely. And additionally, we have used them before. We've had really good experience with them. So that was our recommendation.
Our first-time bidders, or I guess I should say first-time vendors who you would consider using, are they required to submit references, if you will, at the time of their bid, or is this something that is uncovered during the analysis process?
Yes, they are required to submit references, but they can choose not to, and that's how we were able to bypass these vendors.
Okay.
This is just an example. It's not the lowest bid, but it is the best bid.
Yeah, partly. You mean we can't just go on Google and accept the opinion of anonymous people about the quality of their work?
Not at this time.
But when you review these, who makes up your team? I mean, you have several, obviously, several people. Can you walk me through
Yeah, we have a large team that would include engineering, legal, material management, just a lot of experts in a lot of areas. So it's really not one business unit. It's the whole company that evaluates these bids.
Yeah, I've scolded you before, not scolded it on the estimates, but you're getting a lot closer on these things.
This was a little higher. Yeah, see? Yeah.
I appreciate it.
Thanks.
This was higher.
I just want to say, I appreciate it.
Any it more questions?
Like a million or something.
Revised estimate.
Good, give it to him on this contract, because then we'll talk about the next one.
Oh, yeah.
Give credit.
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks.
Okay, seeing no comments. Any comments from the public on this item? Seeing none. Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 8, resolution number 6022. Now therefore be it resolved that by the Board of Directors of Omaha Public Power District, that one, the proposal of McLean Power Systems in the amount of $1,753,056 for the purchase of all insulators and a portion of the hardware as shown by line item on the attached Exhibit A1 is hereby accepted and approved. And two, the proposal of Chris Davis Company in the amount of $284,933.47 for the purchase of the remaining balance of the hardware as shown by line item on the attached Exhibit A2 is hereby accepted and approved.
Yeah. So moved.
Oh.
Second.
Where insulators and hardware that go along with the project. There are going to be 630 transmission structures. Some of the insulators are going to be polymer so they don't explode. They're all the things that go along with it, the clamps, the pins, the anchor parts, the plates, bolts, nuts, washer, clips, etc. And for the best economic resolution of the issue, $1,079,000 was provided to McLean for their insulators and some hardware, and $258,000 to Critz Davis for the balance of the hardware. $285,933.47 to be exact. So you can see what it is that gets attached to these bolts by the graph, which is up. The engineer's estimate on this project was about $1.9 million and came in at $1,300,000.
This is clean bed.
Okay, are there other comments from board members on this item? Seeing none, anyone from the public here to comment? Okay, seeing no one? Okay, please call roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Agenda item number 9, resolution number 6023. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the board meeting schedule for 2015 as outlined on Exhibit A attached here to is hereby approved.
So move.
Second. Fred?
Chairman Kavanaugh, and this is our normal meeting date where we publish schedule our meetings for the following year. The 2015 meeting schedule is outlined in Exhibit A. It includes one evening board meeting scheduled for August, and I recommend its approval. We have had some internal discussions amongst ourselves about revising this at a future date, which we can do to add more or change some conditions and times. But at this point, we'd like to go forward with this schedule so people can make plans for dates, and if we decide to revise this in January, we certainly can.
But the dates will probably remain the same. It's just the time.
For the travel of the senior vice presidents.
Right.
So they can make their
schedule. Okay, seeing that, anyone from the public here to comment?
Yes. Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Okay, our next items 10 and 11, we have two presentations. First one will be dealing with our corporate operating plan and electric service tariff updates. And in conjunction with that, the following presentation will be concerning our economic development rate presentation. Okay, Greg, you want to take it back?
Gotta move.
Thank you, Chairman Cavanaugh. I'll just kick this off, and then our Chief Financial Officer, Edward Easterman, will go through a detailed review of our corporate operating plan, the impact on rates, and then we're going to hear about a new rate that we're proposing for economic development, and Tammy Monroe will cover that. 2014 was a monumental year for us. Those of you that have been following OPPD during that time, we had a lot of activity. It didn't happen by happenstance. There was a lot of strategic planning and dedication of our workforce, and a lot of hard work by the men and women of our company, as always is the case. Let me start with the successful restart of Fort Calhoun Station. It's been a long journey that restored 478 megawatts of clean carbon-free power to OPPD's diverse portfolio of fuels. It's a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week plant. We're extremely proud of the work put forth by the men and women around the whole company, not only at Fort Calhoun, but it was an entire company effort to restart the unit. I'm proud to say the plant's been safely running for over 236 days at about a 96% capacity factor since startup. Another major accomplishment was the successful integration of OPPD into the Southwest Power Pool. You've heard us talk about this as we've gone through the year. It's a collection of 76 utilities, generators, and transmission companies serving 15 million people across the 9-state area that includes Nebraska, Oklahoma, Missouri, and Kansas. As a member, we joined this new integrated marketplace that went live at midnight on March 1. The market is where wholesale power for the next day is sold and bought. This innovative approach is designed to determine which generating units should run for the next day for maximum cost effectiveness, improve the regional supply-demand balance, and provide participants with a greater access to reserve electricity. It also helps with integration of renewable resources, which is a growing part of our portfolio mix, headed toward 33%. As you can imagine, this didn't happen overnight, but after months of planning and getting ready and testing, the transition went without a blip, and we successfully traded in this energy marketplace since that March 1. But we didn't stop there. We took on major initiatives to look at our resource generation, especially when it came to fossil fuel plants. But we wanted our customer input as to what it was important to them, since our mission is to be affordable, reliable, and environmentally sensitive. The key is, how do you balance those three elements? So we went out and asked our stakeholders, and they definitely told us what was important to them. After months of outreach and strategic planning from the resource generation experts, we were able to develop a plan that meets the needs of all of our customers. I'm again proud to say that in June of this year, OPPD's Board of Directors approved a recommendation from senior management to put OPPD front and center in the national spotlight as a utility that found an affordable and environmentally sensitive solution to the upcoming environmental requirements. But we could not do this without all our customers, and making sure we provide a high level of customer satisfaction has always been a hallmark of this utility. And we are so proud of our high level of customer satisfaction and the men and women that make that happen. We appreciate that you, our customers, voted OPPD as one of the top trusted electric utility brands in the Midwest by the 2014 Utility Trusted Brand and Customer Engagement Study. It's a first of a kind for the industry. The survey included residential customers serving 125 of the country's largest natural gas, electric, and combination utilities. The results measured brand trust, operational satisfaction, and product experience. But our work is not done. We're here to talk about the 2015 operating plan. While we've done a tremendous amount of testing of our basic emission controls on our fossil fuel plants, and we're pleased with the outcome as we've reported previously. We now need to implement the plans. We're going beyond the testing stage into implementation. Like many of our endeavors, this too shall take the focus of many of our employees, but due to our extensive testing, we know it will be successful. We know it works. Regarding Fort Calhoun Station, we recently received positive feedback that the plant is nearing the end of our increased oversight by the NRC. We have another public meeting scheduled early in the year in 2015 with our goal to return to the normal oversight process. As you have seen, the utility industry is highly regulated, and we are seeing it from all aspects, environmental, nuclear, transmission, and distribution. We'll continue our efforts and always be in compliance with those issues and be leaders, not just to be great, but strive for excellence. That's our target. While many areas of the U.S. have not seen much growth, we're fortunate in Nebraska that we continue to see some growth. And it's important that we serve those new and existing customers, and that's why it's important we continue to invest in the construction of transmission facilities to serve those customers. But it's equally important that we maintain safe and reliable service. We'll continue to respond quickly and efficiently when outages occur. Hand in hand with those goals is a renewed ongoing emphasis in employee safety. That's key. The OPPD family, our target is to have everybody come home in the same way they came to work. And the men and women of this company answer to outages, as I've passionately said before, our folks go out when the rest of us may hunker down before a fireplace, but the team goes out to fix whatever needs to be fixed. As you can see, we are working hard to position OPPD in your business as your business energy source for a successful future. As always, we will continue to focus on making sure you receive affordable, reliable, and environmentally sensitive service. And now to cover the details of the corporate operating plan, potential rate impacts. This is a preliminary view. The board will not be voting today. Edward Easterlin, our CFO, has those details and will present the presentation. Edward.
Thank you, Gary. The 2015 corporate operating plan includes known data for 2015 and then estimates. Those estimates are based on assumptions. And to make those assumptions, we have several areas we'd like to highlight for you as they form a major part of the plan. First of all, on the revenue side, we've included a 1.6% average increase in general rates effective January 1st, 2015. Secondly, there's no change in the fuel and purchase power adjustment. We'll leave the current rate in place for the remainder of 14 and 15. And then third, with that same rate, we're projecting that we'll fully recover the outstanding fuel and purchase power balance associated with the cost related to the flood and the outage at Fort Calhoun Station. Turning from the revenue side to our retail energy sales, when we look at budget to budget, 2014 to 2015, we see a slight increase, a 0.2% increase in sales. So from a budget to budget standpoint, the sales forecast is relatively flat. However, when we look at 2014 projected data compared to the 2015 budget, we see about a 2.5% increase. The reason for that increase and the difference between those two numbers is in 2014, we've experienced mild weather conditions. And with the mild weather, we have less retail sales, and therefore our sales are down year to date. Just a point here that when we develop our budget and what's included in the 2015 corporate operating plan, we use normal weather conditions. And the reason we use normal weather is there's a 50-50 chance that the sales will be either higher or lower than the weather pattern that's been assumed. In this case, we're running below forecast. Turning from retail to wholesale, there's a 7.8% increase projected for wholesale revenues. And on the expenditure side, our capital and operating and maintenance expenditures are planned to maintain system reliability and to meet future load growth. Turning to financing, as mentioned earlier and some of the information that was provided, we are proposing a $100 million increase in new bonding. That is to fund general construction. With regard to our savings account, we have a rate stabilization reserve that we hold funds in the event that we have an unexpected event. This is very similar to a personal savings account that you have at home, where something comes along you didn't expect, you have some place to go to meet that unexpected cost and obligation. We have $37 million in there today, and we project to maintain that through the end of 2015. Outage accruals, 2015, we have a refueling outage for Fort Calhoun Station. The way we account for that is we incur that expense. We then take that expense and we amortize it over the following 18 months, which is the fuel life of the fuel that's added to the reactor. What that does, in essence, is records the fuel-related and outage-related expense in 2015 that's related to that period, and that defers the other expense into 2016. It also has an impact on the rate proposal that you'll see a little bit later. Deferred expenditures, this is related to the Fort Calhoun Station outage and the expenses for restart recovery. Here, those expenses have been captured and they're being amortized over a 10-year period. 2014 is the first year of that amortization period. And so in 2015, we will begin year two of the amortization process. Looking at the units, our generating units themselves and our planned outages, I mentioned the Fort Calhoun Station outage scheduled for the spring. It's a 45-day outage. We have Nebraska City Unit 2 scheduled for 23 days, and then we have 9-day outages for North Omaha Units number 2, 3, and 4, and then a 30-day outage for North Omaha 5. We currently have Sarpy County Unit number 3 in an overhaul outage, which is a 266-day outage, and that's scheduled for completion in May of 2015. And in addition, we have a number of shorter outages for our other peaking units. Now, turning from our assumptions, looking at our revenue projections, we take our sales forecast that I mentioned earlier, we apply that to our current rates and the rate adjustment to project what our future revenues are going to be. In 2015, we're projecting $898 million. That compares to $862 million in 2014. That's a $36 million increase, also a 4.2% increase in revenue. That 4.2% is made up of basically two things: the 2.5% increase in sales that I mentioned, and then also the 1.6% rate increase. You can see the contributions, or the revenue contributions by customer class, as shown as the color-coded sections of each bar. 2015 is broken out there for clarity purposes. The blue portion is for residential customers. That reflects $375 million. The green portion is for commercial at $301 million. Gray represents industrial revenues at $203 million. And the red is for government and municipals at $19 million. Turning to the next revenue class, being wholesale, we have two main categories there. The first one on the bottom is for off-system sales. Those are revenues that we receive for selling excess energy available in our system into the wholesale market through the Southwest Power Pool that was mentioned earlier this morning. There, we're projecting $142 million of wholesale revenue. And in addition to that, we have $65 million for reimbursement from the Nebraska City 2 participants for their share of the operating cost of Nebraska City Unit 2. In total, $207 million, and that's $7 million less than is projected for 2014. The last revenue and income category is other operating revenue and non-operating income. We have a number of items that go into this. So in 2015, the total projection is $34 million. You can see the categories there shown in the box. The first one is transmission wheeling revenue. This is where other companies are using our transmission system to transfer or deliver energy across our system. That represents a sizable portion. The next is interest income in the green. On top of interest income, you can see products and services. Those are services that we sell our customers on a voluntary basis. And then the top is for other electric revenue, and that includes a whole number of items, including rents and things of that nature. Turning from revenues and income into expenses, the first area we'll look at is operation and maintenance expense. In total, 2015 includes $826 million. Those items are also broken out there in those categories that you can see. And that compares to $813 million for 2014. The first category in the blue actually looks a little gray, is $190 million, and that's fuel. The next category in green is for production. This represents the operation and maintenance cost for our generating facilities, the cost of converting that fuel into electrical energy. That's followed by A&G, administrative and general costs. A&G includes a number of items, including corporate services that are provided to support the operating areas of production and transmission and distribution, but it also includes benefit costs for all of the OPPD employees and retirees. And the next category, the red color, is transmission and distribution expenditures. That's the cost of delivering the energy that's produced at the generating stations to the various customers. Next is purchase power. This is where we are purchasing energy on the market for use within our system. That's $86 million. And then customer accounts is $31 million. Turning from O&M to capital investment, we're projecting $286 million for 2015. That's $120 million more than is projected for 2014. Categories there include transmission and distribution at $91 million, nuclear production at $78 million. The other category is really general plant and other at $42 million. And then the last category is fossil production at $75 million. I'll kind of highlight some of the large capital programs and projects that are included in those categories. First, we have MATS compliance, environmental regulations and emission controls. That's $41 million. We have Fort Calhoun containment internal structures. That's budgeted at $17 million. We have fire protection upgrades at Fort Calhoun Station for $9 million. The Sarpy County Unit Number 3 overhaul that I mentioned earlier, that is $5 million, and Fukushima-related compliance is $3 million. On the transmission distribution side, we have the Maryville transmission line, which was also discussed this morning. The board voted to approve the conductor for that line. The total cost is $26 million in 2015. And then we have the TDIP program, or Transmission Distribution Improvement Program, at $20 million. Now, we pay for capital investments from two sources. The first source is internally generated funds or revenues that are collected through our rates. The second source is the issuance of bonds. And you can see the $100 million of bond issuance that was requested this morning. That will fund part of the $266 million of capital investments that you saw on the prior graph. The other will be coming from revenues and funds that we have available to us to fund that capital. If we put everything together, our revenues and expenses, we can project our net income for the year. And we're currently projecting $58 million for 2015. That compares to $50 million for 2014. Now, the $50 million is about $9 million, almost $10 million less than the 2014 budget. And that's really as a result of the revenues I mentioned earlier due to mild weather conditions. So turning from net income, looking at our savings account, if you will, I mentioned in the assumptions that we're projecting to maintain the $37 million that we currently have available in that account in 2014 and 15. However, I will also mention that given the revenue shortfalls that we've experienced year to date, there may be a need to withdraw some of that money at year end. How much? We don't know at this point. part. We don't know whether we will need to or not, but it's expected to be relatively small if we do. Our debt ratio is a measure of our capital structure. It tells us what percent of our assets is funded with debt versus equity. And we're currently at 51%, and in 2015, we're projected to remain at 51%. This says that of our assets, 51% is financed with debt, and 49% is financed with equity. This is a very good measure for a public utility, because we can't issue stock and generate equity through the issuance of stock. We basically have two ways of generating equity. One is through coverage and investment of revenues into capital, and then the repayment of debt obligations. Another important category for us is coverage ratios. This is very closely watched by our investors and our creditors. The reason they like it so much, it really tells them how much financial flexibility we have as an organization. They're very concerned about our indebtedness, because if you're an investor, you don't want an organization to keep borrowing money, because then your claim on the company's revenues become a smaller and smaller percentage of that company's revenue stream. We have a target of 2.0 times for total debt service, which is the green line. So to calculate that, we take all the revenues that come in. From that, we subtract our O&M expenses and payment in lieu of taxes. And that tells us how much money we then have available to pay for our debt. And then we divide that number by our total debt payment. Higher the number, the better. 2.0 means we can pay our debt twice. We can pay that mortgage payment and then have that much money left over to make sure we have working capital to run the business and to invest revenues back into capital expenditures. The blue line on the top is for senior lien debt coverage. We have senior lien debt, we have subordinate lien debt, and then we also have separate system, which you heard this morning. That's not reflected up here. The senior lien debt is a higher ratio because there's less debt outstanding at the senior lien. The total would include the senior and the subordinate lien. The bottom line is a fixed charge. That includes total debt service plus any contractual obligations that are debt-like. In other words, if we're taking another resource that we have a contractual arrangement with for capacity or energy, and we have to pay for that, whether or not it produces or we receive, that's called a take-or-pay contract. Those payments are then included in this calculation because it functions just like debt. Days cash on hand are projected at 123 days. It tells us how much liquidity we have, how long we could operate the business if we had a disruption in our cash flow, the revenue collection, if you will. So have 123 days. Our minimum is 100. That compares very favorably to the period. At the end of 14, we're projecting 147. We have retained NewGen Strategies and Solutions, which is a utility consultant, to review the budget and the corporate operating plan on behalf of the board and provide an independent assessment and opinion to the board. We expect to have that report prior to the December board meeting. In summary, our mission is to provide affordable, reliable, and environmentally sensitive energy services to our customers. We believe the plan achieves that mission. First of all, our rates remain below the regional and national average. Expenditures are sufficient to maintain system reliability, and renewable resources generate approximately 16% of our retail energy in 2015. In addition, we have a number of other areas we pursue around continuous improvement. We're managing our O&M expenditures, we're prioritizing managing our capital investments, and we're always seeking to identify and manage our risk. So with that, I'm gonna turn over to the tariff update and the proposed rate increase and highlight what goes into making that determination. The first as in the corporate operating plan, are assumptions. The main assumption here is that this is based on the preliminary corporate operating plan that I just discussed with you. So that information comes directly over into this analysis. Here we've also hired a consultant, CH2M Hill, to act on the board's behalf as a reviewer, an independent source of review, and provide opinion to the board, and I'll touch on that a little bit later during the discussion. We take the corporate operating plan and we perform what's called a cost of service study. And that cost of service study takes that information and puts it into certain cost categories, some of which you have already seen in the corporate operating plan. But it breaks it out between the cost obligations of a number of customers, including retail customers, as well as, say, the Nebraska City 2 participants. The Nebraska City 2 participant cost is not included in what I'm going to show you here because they are paying their cost directly through a contractual arrangement. So here, we have what's called a retail revenue requirement. This represents the cost of operating OPPD system to serve our retail customers for 1 year. The categories include operations and maintenance at $802 million. The second area is debt service. This is our principal and interest payment for our debt obligations, very similar to your mortgage payment of $130 million. Capital Improvement Fund, these are the funds that we collect through coverage that come back and are available to fund a portion of that $286 million capital program that I mentioned to you. That's $130 million. And then payment in lieu of taxes at $33 million. These are payments that we make to the municipalities and the counties in which we own and operate facilities. Total, $1.095 billion for 2015. We then take our resources and we pursue activities to generate additional income to offset as much of that cost as we can. The first category is off-system sales. So we're selling into SPP to generate revenues to offset the cost of operating the system. There we have $138 million projected. Other revenue, $28 million. In total, $166 million. We subtract the $166 million from the $1.095 million to come up with the net retail revenue requirement of $929 million. This is the cost we need to collect from retail sales to pay for the cost of operating the system. We compare the $929 million to the revenues that we would collect through our current rates. That estimate is $914 million. That provides a deficiency of $15 million. $15 million represents a 1.6% rate increase. The drivers for the rate increase, first of all, we have increased nuclear expenses. There is recognition of the Fort Calhoun refueling outage expense I mentioned earlier. That cost was not included in the 2014 budget. Was not included in the 2014 rate review. 2015, we have the cost, we have the rates. It was not funded as such in the current rates. Second, we have increased decommissioning funding. What happens here is we have a decommissioning obligation for a point in the future at a certain dollar amount. We have funds invested to meet that obligation, and then we invest those funds to earn income. What's happening is our income, our investment returns are declining, just as our personal savings accounts are, with lower interest rates. And through that, we see shortfalls in the amount of money available at decommissioning. The way we make up for that is we increase our funding to make up for that reduction in investment income. The next area, increased benefit costs. Here we have healthcare costs is increasing from 2014 to 15. The increase is approximately 7%. The next category is pension funding and OPEB, other post-employment benefits. Pension funding and OPEB are based on actuarial calculations. The good news for everyone in the room is that your life expectancy has just increased. The new mortality tables say we're all living longer. Great news. The difficulty with that is You need to fund more for your retirement. And as we increase our liabilities associated with retirement funding, we have to increase our funding to make up for that increase in liability. The last area is increase capital expenditures. You saw that on the graph, the $120 million increase. You saw where the money was being invested. With this increase, we have the additional interest and debt expense associated with it. So what have we done to reduce the rate increase? You saw the revenue credits, but here's another look at that in a little different perspective. First of all, the sales of excess energy, this is the wholesale, this is the margin. This is what we're bringing back above what it's costing us to sell. The second is amortization of Fort Calhoun Station restart and recovery operating and maintenance expenses. We looked at 2015. We have some activities in 2015 that are recovery related that classify or can be considered for deferment and amortization. So we have taken those out of 2015. We put them into amortization class, and those costs get amortized over the remaining 9 years of that 10-year period. The second is the outage expense. I mentioned we take that outage expense and we amortize it over 18 months instead of expensing it all in 2015. So what that does is it puts $16 million worth of expense in 2015 and then moves $20 million of expense in 2016. That helps mitigate the rate proposal for 2015. Going through a cost of service study is a very detailed process, and we take those costs and we break them down in a lot of different categories, and then we look at the individual tariffs and we compare what the cost is included in those tariffs versus what that cost of service says. And based on that, we determine what the increase is by tariff, which then tells us what the increase is by customer class. So as we look at the residential customer class, we see that the average residential bill today is about $102.40 per month. Under the proposal, it would increase to $104.03, or $1.63 per month change, which is a 1.6% increase. We take that same approach for commercial, industrial, and lighting, and you can see the corresponding increases there of 1.3%, 2.2%, 0.6%, with an overall average of 1.6. Now, I'll point out the note on the bottom because this is very important. As we know, there is no such thing as an average customer. Everyone uses the product a little bit differently, so the impact on every bill will be a little bit different than what's displayed here.
Yeah, and if you possibly point out the thought process and why residential customers increased 1.6, let's say, and industrial customers 2.2.
It goes back to that cost of service process that I mentioned. So as we go through that, we look at what the actual cost is for that customer class through those tariffs versus what the tariff is actually providing for. And what we try to do is, at any given time, some customers may be paying a little more than their costs, some customers paying a little less. And so over time, we try to true that up so that we have parity among all rate customers and classes.
It's trying to be fair and also legal.
Correct. We're not allowed to discriminate one customer versus the other. And so that's why we use the standard cost of service approach to do it. Next item is to look at rate increases around the region. And here we see that across the river in Iowa, Mid-American is looking at a 3.5% increase for 2015. They proposed a 13.15% increase for Illinois. NPPD has announced that they will not be having a rate increase in 2015. In the state of Missouri, we have Empire District and KCP&L are both proposing and planning to implement rate increases as shown. Wisconsin Public Service, 8% is proposed. Lincoln Electric System, a 0% increase proposed. Northern States Power, Wisconsin, 3.2%. And then Xcel Energy in Minnesota is proposed to 5.6. So what does all this mean and how does it compare? If we include the 1.6% increase in OPPD's rates, we can calculate what our average retail rate is projected to be in 2015. That's 8.53 cents per kilowatt hour. If we compare that to the average of all the utilities in the west north central region of the U.S., which is where we're located, we calculate a regional rate average of 9.48 cents per kilowatt hour. That puts OPPD 10% below the regional average. We then look at the U.S., the national average, and that's projected at 10.65 cents per kilowatt hour. And then we are 19.9% below the national average. In addition to the general rate increase, we have a number of other proposed changes. Some of those are miscellaneous consumer service charge changes. There are changes in the line extension policy for residential charges. There's increases in disconnect charges and pole attachment fees. Other items include additional street lighting options that are available, and then the elimination of one rate rider, and we currently don't have any customers on that rider, and then restriction of another rider where we're proposing not to add new customers on that one. There's more information available in the packet on those particular items. Now the next graph is a little complex, so I'm going to try to do my best to explain it, but I think it's very insightful and provides a unique perspective. This graph represents OPPD's cents per kilowatt hour over time relative to the inflation rate. So if you start on the left, in 1985, OPPD's cents per kilowatt hour, which is what I just presented for 2015, in 1985 it was 4.97 cents per kilowatt hour. We've taken that rate for every year for the last 30 years and we've discounted it for the rate of inflation. Okay? And doing that provides that green line. And the key to this is it's the slope of the line. If our rates had increased exactly equal to the rate of inflation, we'd have a flat line across the page. If our rates increased higher than the rate of inflation, we would have an upward sloping line. What this shows is our rates have increased less than the rate of inflation, and it's actually a downward sloping line. So today, in 2015, as we look forward, the effective rate, if you discount for inflation in 2015, is less than it was in 1985. Now, to show this from a different perspective, the 1985 actual rate of 4.97 compared to the 2015 projected rate of 8.53, you can determine what the average annual increase is between those two numbers. And it turns out it's 1.8% per year. So our rates have increased 1.8% per year for the last 30 years. If they had increased at the rate of inflation, which is 2.7% per year, our proposal would be for 11.17 cents per kilowatt hour, which is 31% higher than what we're proposing. Now, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have a consultant that has been retained to review this information on behalf of the board. So they're currently evaluating these recommendations, the cost of service study that I mentioned, and they are planning to provide a report or a letter to the board of directors prior to the December board meeting. In summary, we're proposing an increase of 1.6%, and that is to the general rates with no change to the fuel and purchase power adjustment. There's also a number of other miscellaneous service charge adjustments included. And the retail cents per kilowatt hour is 10% below the regional average and 19.9% below the national average. We presented this information Tuesday during board committee. We're presenting it again today. On Tuesday, we provided a notice on our website and also to the local media through our traditional practice. We plan to come back on December 18th and request board approval.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Easterlin said we have a new rate option that we'd like to present to the board for their consideration. This new rate option is an economic development rate, which is an important tool to create new business opportunities to bring new customers and new expansion into our service territory. This rate will be utilized to attract new industrial customers. And before I go through the details of the rate, what I'd like to do is share some of the benefits we see for our customers by using this new economic development rate. Bringing new customers to our service territory provides a variety of benefits. The first one is that by bringing new customers in, we increase the system utilization and load factor. Utility systems are built to serve our customers. Customer usage fluctuates, and as that fluctuation happens, they don't fully utilize the system all hours of a day. What we continue to do is generate that electricity, and then that excess amount is sold into the wholesale market. Now, as you've heard this morning, we use the Southwest Power Pool as the market where we sell our excess electricity. And that's been very good for our business. The downside of that is it's a demand and supply market, so there's no guarantee that we're going to sell that electricity, and there's no guarantee on price. So attracting new industrial customers with a higher load factor increases the system utilization. It also keeps the low-cost electricity local. Selling to our retail customers is our number one priority, and selling to those customers is the most efficient use for all of benefit of all of our customers. Now, bringing new customers to our service territory also helps mitigate future rate increases. Utilities are generally a highly intensive fixed cost industry, and what that means is we build generating sources and we operate those. We build and maintain transmission and distribution systems to move power around, and it takes a lot of fixed costs to do that. Bringing in larger customers and increasing that customer base helps to increase the fixed cost recovery. Okay. Having an economic development rate is an advantage in recruiting customers. We compete against other states, other cities, other utilities for these customers, and they do nationwide searches to where their locations would be the best for their operations, and many other utilities already provide this economic development rate as an option. Other benefits are to the local economy. As new customers come into the service territory, and industrial customers in particular, they create new jobs. With new jobs, there's a multiplier effect that brings new people into the community. Those people are going to buy houses, they're going to go out to eat, they're going to shop, they're going to buy groceries, and all of those things help expand the economy. As the economy expands, there's also opportunity then for us to see new residential customers as well as new commercial customers. The last of the benefits is around taxes. The Omaha Public Power District does not pay property tax, but what we do pay is in lieu of tax payments to the counties, and that's based on the retail sales in incorporated towns and municipalities. So as those retail sales increase, so will those tax payments to those counties. Now you can see there are quite a few benefits to bringing new customers and expanding load in our service territory. Some of the companies that we have heard from that are interested in coming are from these types of industries. There's manufacturing companies looking at us, there's data centers, and there's bioscience companies, as well as some other types of industries. Now, the state of Nebraska is very involved in economic development, and they have passed a statute, and the statute section is there at the top. It's 70-6552, and that statute allows for public utilities to offer a discount on their electric rates. These statutes set the minimum requirements. The minimum requirement is the discount cannot exceed 5 years, so that's the maximum discount we can offer. The protection component of the rate that we offer has to be greater than the incremental cost of production. So we can't sell the product for less than what it costs to produce. We would do that anyway, but that's part of the law. And what that does is that helps protect our existing customers from any adverse impact because we offer a discount. Now on the customer side, there's some requirements on the customer side by the state. They, after receiving benefits from the Nebraska Advantage Act, they have to have a minimum of 60% annual load factor with a 500 kW demand. And these, as I said, are the minimums. OPPD's proposed economic development rate contains the following components. OPPD must have excess generating capacity available to offer the rate. So we're going to only offer the discount rate on anything that our current customers are not utilizing. The rate will only be available to loads which would not otherwise have located in OPPD's territory. The discount cannot adversely impact any other customers. And the other OPPD rates, terms, and conditions will apply. So a couple of those examples are the line extension policy and the fuel and purchase power adjustments. The economic development rate has to be compliant with the Nebraska Economic Development Statutes. It's kind of a given. Customer requirements are new load, which has to be 2,500 kilowatts or 2.5 megawatts at a 60% load is the minimum. They were required to take service under one of our industrial rates, which is 232, 240, 245, or 250. And the customer will select the term that they would like to have the discount for. The terms we're offering are anywhere from 3 to 5 years, so they will make that selection. And if they choose to take service under this rate, there'll be an economic development agreement with that customer, so there'll be a contract with them. And the contract term will be twice the length of the discount rate. So if they select a 3-year discount, they will have a 6-year contract. Those contracts are take or pay. And the reason we put this stipulation in is we don't want customers to come in, take the discount for 3 to 5 years, and then move load to some other place. We want to make sure we've got long-term customers that are coming. The rate itself is a formula-based rate, and our other formula-based rate is the fuel and purchase power adjustment. We'll update the costs associated with this and the conditions on an annual basis. So we will go out and evaluate how much extra capacity we have each year. Discount is limited to excess capacity. It's calculated on an annual basis. We use the forward price curves in those wholesale markets to determine what the discount will be. When we set the discount, we want to make sure the revenue we're collecting from these customers will exceed anything that we could make for our existing customers out in the wholesale market. So that's how they're not adversely impacted. Applies to new and expanding qualified customers, and the discount is fixed for the contract period. So this rate is approved in 2015, and we have a customer that comes in and wants to utilize this rate. They'll select their period, and whatever the discount is, that's what they get for that contract. In 2016, we'll go
evaluate the conditions again. And if that discount rate changes, that's the discount that people was applying in 2016 get. We do not go back and adjust any of those rates. Okay, this is the 2015 proposed discount. Customers have two options. First option is a flat rate that will be 5.9% for whatever years they select. The second option is only available for 5-year contracts, and it's a declining balance discount. This is an example of a customer bill. This is a 240 customer with an 80% load factor. The first three components on the screen are what they would have on their existing bill. So they have a demand charge, which is $30,700. The energy they take is $53,144. Basic service charge is $422. They would have a sub bill of $84,266. We apply the discount to those three items. So this bill, this customer we assumed was taking a 5.9% discount. That's $4,972 for discount for that month, and then they would pay the full FPPA, which is the $31.39. So you can see at the bottom, their total bill is $82,433. Okay. In summary, an economic development rate would do the following. Attracts new customers and new load growth to OPPD's territory. Improves the utilization of the existing systems we have. Keeps low-cost energy in Nebraska. Keeps low-cost costs for all of our customers. And it benefits the local economy. Okay, this rate, we presented this Tuesday at the committee meeting for the Board of Directors. We're presenting this information again this morning. And then in the December 18th Board of Directors meeting, we would request approval to implement this rate.
Comments on the presentation we had today, or is anyone from the public here to comment at this time on the items, the presentations we just had? Again, we'll have a month to digest the proposed budget and so forth, and before we make a decision, we'll vote on it at our December meeting. John? Address, please.
Thank you, John Adkison, Nebraska Wildlife Federation, and 4751 South 18th Street. It's really a question, how do you determine what is the average or normal weather from which you make your projections?
We look at a historical period and we determine what the average weather conditions were for those periods, and that defines, and I think right now we're using a 20-year average, and then we apply that to our historical sales to adjust those sales for above or below normal conditions, and then we use that to project forward.
And the point I'm getting to is that, of course, climate is what you expect and weather is what you get, what we have to actually deal with, and the climate scientists are predicting that the next 20 years are going to be becoming more and more significantly different than the previous 20 years, and I wonder if you've included a correction for that, or plan to do that?
We will include variances that we see in actual experience. So we don't have any forecasted data with regard. And my understanding is that any variance that will be received will be in the volatility of weather, not so much in the overall level. So we may see a larger standard deviation from year to year, mm-hmm. right? And that the problem with averages is there is no such thing as an average.
Right.
So you know, we could have a very normal weather, but pattern, but have very severe and very mild at the same time. And that the volatility is the hard thing to capture.
I would agree with that as far as it goes. However, I hope everyone here takes the opportunity to reference the new study from UNL that came out on September 25th, which is specifically an assessment of climate change and its implications for Nebraska. In the executive summary, which is certainly the part I prefer, and the whole report. It's the whole report is very rich. But they project that in a relatively short period of time, the weather that we saw in 2012, which was not real easy for any of us and certainly not easy for utilities, will in fact become the new normal. And so, you don't just get to a certain point, flip a switch, and all of a sudden that's the new normal. It's some kind of progression, and we don't know how that will go. But we can expect a trend in that direction according to the people who are the experts and who should most know what the heck they're talking about. So I would urge you to take that very seriously into consideration in your strategic planning and even in your medium-term planning, because this is something we're not used to taking into account, but it's getting sort of late in the game to do that. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Crystal Craig, 7110 South 76th Street in La Vista. I had a question about the excess electricity produced equals a discount for potential future industrial using customers. Okay, and so that discount is only available for the amount that is produced in excess, correct? I'm curious about how can we get numbers on the excess that's been produced. I understand that we're, in order to be in compliance with the Southwest Power Pool regulations, we have to produce an additional 14%, then more than what we use to be available to sell. So how much excess is being and has been produced that's going to be available for this discounted rate?
Do you have any kind of estimate on that, Ed, or is it something that's somewhat difficult to estimate right now?
With the Southwest Power Pool, we have a reserve margin requirement, which means we have a system peak, and then we have to have capacity a certain percentage above that peak to account for unexpected conditions like weather extremes. And I believe that is 13%?
Plus 13%.
Plus or minus a couple of percent. So today, as we said, we meet that requirement and we have some capacity in addition to that. As we look at this rate proposal, we look at that, our projected peak demands and our capacity over time, and in the five-year period, I think the proposal is to limit the available capacity on that rate to 70 megawatts. Because we believe, based on our projections, we will have 70 megawatts of excess capacity during that period and still satisfy the SPP requirement.
Okay. So do you have a number in megawatts of what that 13 plus percent is that you can you?
I don't have it off the top of my head, but I can get that for you. And it's about 13.5%.
13.5. Okay. I'll talk to you after. Thanks.
Thank you, Crystal.
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street. Two concerns, really. One is to see how the, I'm concerned about how the effort to attract new customers, spread out the load, et cetera, dovetails with the energy conservation goal that you also have in order to avoid increasing capital costs in the future for new generation. The other is that your risk profile from weather is actually changing. To kind of go with John's remarks, it's hard to tell whether the weather fluctuations are actually going to get larger or not. But one thing that I can tell you is that one of your bigger risks for capital costs on transmission is if you get a big ice storm. And the biggest ice storms are more toward the Bible Belt than they are toward the Corn Belt. So as climate conditions change over time, the ice storm belt is going to be coming north because it's going to be gradually getting to be easier to get Gulf moisture up into this part of the country in the winter when it's easier to generate a freezing rain event. The other factor, and this one is doesn't even involve speculation about how fast that's going to happen. You've got a transmission line to Maryville. That you're adding on right now. The highest risk for ice storms is in southeast Nebraska, and you're putting a transmission line into an area that's even higher risk. And I encourage you to be aware of that, and if possible, to get some operating weather statistics from some of the neighboring utilities that are already in northwest Missouri to see how their frequency of icing events that damage power lines and so forth varies from what we're used to in Nebraska. Thank you.
Would anyone care to address the John's cost versus conservation?
You know, I think they actually dovetail. And so as we begin to think about our demand-side management initiatives and the support of the economic development incentive rate, is that as we begin to think about lowering that peak demand, that reshapes that load factor of our customers. And so the economic development rate really is the intent to incent higher load factors that would actually level out OPPD system load. So it actually increases the efficiency of our system, and they really dovetail very clearly together. Because what we're seeing from the new potential customers, having lunch with one of them that's looking at the area yesterday, relatively high load factor, 90% load factor, very focused on environment efficiency, and even potentially in this customer's mind, purchase of additional renewable energy that they may be interested in. So it really dovetails with the OPPD mission overall.
Thank you.
Hey, John, one quick question. Do you have a weather forecast for...
That'll come later. That's for general remarks. I'm trying to stick to your agenda here.
Details
Laverne Drayan, 321 South 32nd Street. So rewarding customers for using more polluting fuel by lowering their rates, personally, I just don't think it's a good idea. So essentially what you're trying to say is you want to get less profit per electron, and you're going to make it up because they're going to use more. That's the McDonald's way of doing things, cheap food and a lot of it for a low price. I would suggest you would use more of a Chipotle or a Smash Burger attempt, which they get a much higher profit per item, even though they sell less items. And for economic development, I would suggest that if a business came to you and said, you know, we want to smash cars and turn it into metal and it takes a lot of energy, you would have a crack team here that would say, well, we can cut your energy in half to smash those cars because we have a crack efficiency team here that knows how to do those things. And then your rate becomes a premium, and you can actually charge more for the rate and explain to the business that it's overall going to be less expensive for them to operate here because of your crack efficiency team that you have here at OPPD. But no, for a centralized polluter, you want to use more. as you develop these efficiency programs and begin using less, instead of shutting down coal plants, which is what we want you to do as you use less, you want to get bigger users to mop up that excess so you can continue to use your dirty coal plants and your dirty nuclear fuel, which is stacking up on the river. Now, for real economic development, and if you really want to lower cost, you move the energy to the user. So you have a big user, you put the energy generator at the user. That's a decentralized system. You're only, again, trying to put Band-Aids on a centralized polluting system instead of converting to a decentralized clean system. And yes, Tim, I would really love sunshine to come out of our out of these sockets when I use it for my camera. And I wish you would take that on as a responsibility of yours instead of asking me to bring a solar panel to run my camera. I ask you to bring a solar panel so I can run my camera because this is a public utility and we're the public. So that's what I'd like for you guys to do is to mop up your dirt and start doing clean and quit rewarding people for using dirty fuel. Thank you and have a nice day.
If we can do our part to improve the economic development in this community at little or no cost to our customers, I'm all for it. That's how I feel, and I think a lot of the other members feel the same way. Thanks for your comments.
Hey, Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
one thing on that, though, I was just thinking as we were watching that presentation, if we could, in the next year or so, I don't know when or whatever, get an update of all the things we are doing on economic development. What I hear from constituents, it's a very, very important aspect of what we do. I think it would be good for new board members to know what we're doing, so I'd like to get that on the agenda at some point. It could be in a committee meeting or general meeting, I don't care, but I think I haven't heard everything we do. I know bits and pieces, but it would be good to have one.
Yes. My name is Carmelita Inigas, 1735 and a half South 15th. I guess some of my concerns are first of all, you know, I agree with him. You know, why are we going to sit there and use all this extra nuclear and coal plants and stuff like that? You're just polluting our future. We can think about our future right now. But really, this isn't for us, because we're going to die off one day or another. Every single one of us are going to die. But we got to think about our kids and our kids' kids. And our kids' kids' kids.
Can we also think about their chances of succeeding in this community and getting good, solid...
How are you helping?
It'll help increase economic development in the community, doing our part.
By polluting everything?
Well, if you want to look at it that way, this, I guess we really can't argue that. Can we?
Okay. So then, what can we do to change it?
We're doing a lot to improve.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to make a point here. This is a comment on what we were discussing. It's not a debate. So I'd like to, if we could keep the comments based on what was discussed during the presentations, and then leave the other open for when we have general comments or to talk directly to board members.
That's fine. We will have a second in the meeting for general comments.
Okay, well, that's one of my concerns. Another concern is, how are we helping some of these poor people, the people who don't have the high-paying jobs and everything like that? Because for myself, I am a single mother. I am trying to better myself with an education, not living on any kind of government assistance. I'm trying to do these things, and what are you guys trying to do to help make things work so we're not having to go without any kinds of lights? I know other college students, other people who are trying, but what, this government is just sitting here screwing us over, so then what, in the end, whoever has kids, they sit there and they what? Oh, cut off your lights. Don't even give any chance or anything like that. If somebody's trying to do something, what are you guys doing to try and help? You guys can go back to your homes and have your electric and whatever, your internet and your cable and all this other stuff. When some of us customers who are giving you guys the jobs are sitting here trying. We're trying to do what we can, but let me sit there and see one of you guys sit there and live, support your kids and try and get ahead in this life with what? $200 bills coming up, stuff like that. Why don't we sit there and help these other parents and families out there who are trying? We're trying to do something. You guys are just taking and taking and taking.
We do have avenues in place to assist people who are struggling to pay their electric bills.
I've tried that avenue. You know what? Oh, well, we don't have any funds. We don't have this. We don't have that. Oh, we got to wait 72 hours. I have a special needs son, and he has machines and stuff like that he needs to use, but you guys don't care. You guys didn't care. Well, we can't do anything. Okay, so when he, what? Just bring him to the hospital? So then what's that going to do? Do you understand? What's that going to do? Put a bigger bill I mean, this is what my concern is to all of you. Why don't you think about some of this? There's a lot of colleges here in this community, am I right?
Ma'am, we're getting a little bit off the topic.
I'm just sitting here stating this point.
We appreciate your struggle.
But I'm just sitting here making a statement here. You know, this is what it's to sit there and have, you know, freedom of speech. You know, to sit there and let all of this be heard. You know, I don't know if anybody else here, either they're going through any kind of hardship or else anything, you know, or maybe you have a neighbor who's going through some of this or a close friend, you know, and you guys all have your guys' nice jobs and everything, can sit here and everything. But let's look at the whole picture on this. You know, look at the whole picture. Why don't you start figuring out something to maybe help some of these parents and stuff to get on their feet so maybe they can get a better paying job, so maybe they can get ahead in this and not have to worry about, am I going to go home and the lights be shut off? Because what? You guys go home at your, what, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and what? No big deal.
So what might you recommend other than you've got the issue?
Mm-hmm.
How do you propose it be solved by this board, by OPPD?
Why don't you sit there and maybe put some kind of funds away to sit there and help somebody who is legitimately struggling on this, but who is trying? I'm not saying the people are just sitting around doing drugs and stuff like that, but people who are really trying, you know, why don't we sit there and start helping them out so they can get back on their feet?
So I'm sorry, but we've heard that part. I want to hear how we solve it.
Okay.
And what I'd like to do is, Tim, could you maybe communicate with her? And I'd also be interested in learning more about our program and how it's funded. Okay. And it would make some sense. It's a great point. We can't solve it here, but I'd like to begin that discussion if it's okay.
That's fine. I appreciate that.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Tim. You'll talk to her after the meeting?
Absolutely.
Thanks.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is President Gates' State of the Utility Report.
Director Cavanaugh, I'll get through this so we have time for any comments that are. Starting as we usually do, just talking through our utility and what's going on with regard to Nebraska City. We did have a 3.5-day outage there to do a lot of work. It started on October 25th and ended on October 28th. That was a successful outage, and the unit has restarted and run well. You know, we talked to you a lot about going to a natural gas line for starting up Nebraska City and would allow us to not use fuel oil and have lower emissions. NC1 is now available with that online gas igniter usage, and Nebraska City 2 is in the process of implementing that gas line. So that's good news overall for not only emissions but just cost to the customers. North Omaha has run well over the reporting period since the last month, and Central Maintenance has a couple of milestones. They supported five outages during the month at various facilities. The men and women did a great job there. But also the machine shop, Department 489, surpassed 16 years without a lost time injury, which is a real, there's one that's a little better I'm going to report on, but that's still a great milestone. And we're working on through our fall outages and next spring's Fort Calhoun outage and planning for that. Peaking plants ran well. You've heard about the Sarpy County overhaul we're doing from Edward Easterlin. It's interesting, since we got into the Southwest Power Pool, the demand starts on our combustion turbines are up quite a bit. That's a natural gas resource. An example, we had 34 combustion turbine starts this month compared to 2 starts in October of 2013. But the peaking plant operations department surpassed 20 years without a lost time injury, and that's well done. Fort Calhoun, as I reported in the preface comments to the corporate operating plan, continues to run well at a 96% capacity factor. One of the major maintenance items we completed was the emergency diesel generator number 1 maintenance window. We obviously work those 24 hours a day to minimize the time that any diesel unit is down, emergency diesel is down. And we're focusing on the refueling outage that's upcoming at Fort Calhoun starting in April of 2015. We had several NRC inspections over the last time period, particularly in emergency planning. They exited on the 10th with no findings or violations going forward. And we're closing out the last of the startup issues that we had, one we've reported before, called high energy line break and electrical equipment qualification, and that's being closed out. And that's a good milestone for us to get by. We continue to integrate Exelon processes in. We're about 230 activities ahead of schedule for the integration of Exelon, the operation of that unit. In regard to transmission and distribution, we hosted 20 arborists from across the state at our Arboretum, which is a great facility.
So we continue to be a leader in that area. And we conducted our annual emergency response drill on Wednesday, November 5th. This is key because we're coming into a season now, as John talked about, the ice on the lines. So we did a very detailed drill on that to make sure we're ready. With regard to customers, we have a new OPPD website that has rolled out. And we're putting a lot of information on it. It allows us to be very responsive for things like the corporate operating plan and our rates, which you'll see on there. And we did get an award from EPRI for Technology Transfer Award. Many of the folks at OPPD were involved in that. It surprised us. We were honored to be recognized that way, but that wasn't our intent for getting into that particular effort. And we did, of course, celebrate Veterans Day. And we have many of our folks that are veterans are currently serving or are deployed. And we want to keep those at the top of mind as we go forward. We also participated in Omaha Diversity Week, and we did have our annual 25-year banquet for folks that have been here 25 years. This was our largest class ever. We had 97 people that crossed that that threshold. Gina Langle was named OPPD's first woman of achievement. She's a senior production engineer with a reputation of supporting her fellow employees and inspiring them to achieve new thoughts. She's done a great job, and she can add this now. And we did do a trade career on display as options for young girls, and that's trades in the sense of what a lot of our union jobs are. They're great, great opportunities for young women. And during that event, the young women got a chance to see what was going on, what was available to them. We partnered with Kiewit, Black Hills, and Metropolitan Community College, LES, and NPPD to do that, including pink hard hats, and I think we have a brief video to show, which will be quick, and that will conclude my report.
Our future workforce is going to look different than it did 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. What we know from research is that children take their careers based on what their parents do and exposure. It's important to create an awareness about trades for girls because they probably don't even consider it. There are many things you may want to do in life. Have you considered this?
Army Trained Women does a career fair, and they've been doing it for about 20 years. And so what we, as a national organization, wanted to do was to help try this out on a much smaller level.
Nebraska Utilities felt like this would be a great opportunity.
Today was a lot of fun, and what I saw today was lots of hands-on activities.
With Black Hills Energy, they learned about the properties of natural gas. With Kiewit, they learned about the construction, the trade jobs in construction, and they built bridges.
The girls learned about line workers, and they got to learn about tying knots and try on the tools. And
they went to Metro Community College's session, and they learned that as a high school student, they could actually start their college education while in high school.
We also got to have a tour of the transportation facility. We
were able to learn a little bit about substation operations and what a substation is. And
saw lots of smiles, heard lots of laughs, and I think one of the most important things that that was part of today was actually having women who are in these trades come in and talk about their jobs.
I think they were really involved, and it's just, so I think they saw some things that they didn't know were expected.
In June, OPPD hosted the 2014 Educator Internship. We immersed these teachers in all the different areas of the district in a one-week period. They came to me and said, how can we continue? I provided that opportunity. Would you like to bring some of your girls in the trades? And they said yes. The word got out to other school districts. We ended up drawing from about 14 different entities, resulting in 79 girls coming and participating. Our pilot program was going to be 50 girls. So you see that there was great interest that we ended up with close to 80. We were thrilled to see that so many of the girls said, gee, I never thought of these careers, and now I want to do them. Or I didn't know OPPD had such jobs, or I didn't know Kiewit had this kind of job, or that I could go to Metro and start my college education while still in high school.
Now they know that they can do some of those things, participate and make a good living and be and have a career that's meaningful. It's a good experience.
What we're going to do is create a toolkit around that to help other utilities partner and do this in their area.
I think that's pretty exciting that we were able to be a part of
not just impacting our own community, but the communities from across the United States. Vents like women in the trades is really critical for us, for our future success. We'll see more students saying, I think I want to do that.
2, 3, 4,
OPPD rocks!
Rocks!
Pretty good. Thanks, Gary.
It's a great, great effort.
Okay, before we adjourn, is there any other members of the public who would care to comment on district business that hasn't been addressed already today?
Hello.
How are you?
David Corbin, 1002 North 49th Street. Just want to, first of all, note and appreciate the number of staff and board members and management that were at the Wind and Solar Conference. And I want to reiterate a question that I asked there. There were statements about the proposal for the EPA requirements, and I'm just wondering whether or not OPPD will be or has already submitted testimony to the EPA on what your views of their proposal, and if so, to what extent did the board and the public have anything to do with that? The same thing goes for now we're entering a new legislative session, and my experience has been in the past years when I go to a committee meeting, your lobbyist comes and tells the board what you're going to support, what bills you're going to support, what you're neutral on, and what you're opposed to, but I never hear any discussion on how the lobbyist arrived at those approvals or neutral or opposition. And I think it would be important for the public to know how you arrived at your stand on the bills, particularly as we're entering into this new legislative session. So I'm asking that you consider those. Thank you.
Good morning. How are you? My name's Tanya Ward. I live at 4826 South 19th Street, and I'm the president and founder of Energy Rescue, Inc. And I sat here and listened to your presentations, and I just thought, holy buckets, my job's just gotten harder again, because we help with people who get shut off from MUD and OPPD. That's what my nonprofit's done since 2007. So I actually help bring money into OPPD from the communities, the churches, the charitable people. So I have two comments for you today and one request. Does OPPD give funds to Salvation Army for shutoffs for your customers?
No, actually, the way it works today, so OPPD receives money through our energy assistance program from our customers, and then what we provide is some administrative support to the community network. That has about 10 different organizations that they can come and get those dollars for electric bill support and needs for those that have been disconnected or those that need assistance because of a variety of different issues. And so we're changing that process a little bit. We're running a pilot this year. We used to do very directly to the American Red Cross, and we used to pay for the administrative support of that, but we're kind of changing the way that looks like for the community, because what I think the community, when we did a little Kaizen event with a variety of community organizations, they found out that not all dollars were being kind of funneled to the right source and to the right need. And so OPPD led that Kaizen event with some other community volunteers and really began to identify this may be a better model to use to help get the money where it needs to get to. And so those dollars essentially go to the organizations that support the needs of the folks that they're trying to assist. Hopefully
that
helps.
Does that include Salvation Army?
I believe it does include Salvation Army.
It does.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So the problem I have today is that those funds that are supposed to help your customers when they get shut off, when you call into your service line, it says call these agencies in 211, and do you know that there's disqualifiers that everybody's on your list is using so that people don't actually get to have help. So, for example, Salvation Army, I went with one of our clients, your customer, and Salvation Army required of her 3 consecutive, consistent, adequate payments, adequate in the mind of the person who is she's speaking with, because it's different when you talk to different people. So 3 consistent, consecutive, adequate payments are required before Salvation Army and agencies following this suit will help with any utility assistance to be restored once they're shut off your customers.
Does that mean they have to have a history of making 3 consecutive payments?
A history of 3, yes, sir.
As opposed to the first month having service and then becoming delinquent right away. You're saying?
Opposed to what, sir?
As opposed to signing up for service and becoming delinquent right away.
Correct. Correct. So those 3 consecutive, consistent, adequate payments, if your customer doesn't have a history of that when they get shut off by you and they go out into the community to find help to get turned back on, they're denied. So Salvation Army is denying the customers help, even though 211 and everybody sends them there because they help with OPPD and MUD shutoffs. It's not happening. So what they do is they require of your customer, my client, to come up with a payment of, let's say, $250 first, and then come back to Salvation Army. And at that time, once that $250 is paid, then Salvation Army will contribute $150 towards that person's shutoff, even though that's not enough money to restore them because you guys require a certain percentage of the total shutoff amount. And a lot of times that's more than in excess of $300. Sometimes it's in excess of $600.
Tim, so, will some of this be the Salvation Army's policies to try to...
Obviously,
we're not the only agency they deal with. There's many other organizations they help out. Is this to take care of, make sure there's no... Nobody's trying to pull the wool over anybody's eyes.
Sure, Chairman Cavanaugh, that's exactly right. That's why we're looking at where we used to deal directly with the American Red Cross. They were going to kind of get out of that business, but the community really has a variety of different organizations. Certainly each organization has their own administrative policy and practice on how they essentially work directly with folks that come to them for need and assistance on a variety of different things. Utility payment is just one of them. And so I would maybe Judy Martin, who's our representative on the community fund, maybe meet with Tanya and talk a little bit about what that may look like. I know when we did the Kaizen event, we had organizations and other community folks, including United Way, to be kind of the organization that may be able to help a customer get to the right spot, and they would use the same kind of application process so that everybody has a common application so they don't have to fill it out 10 different times. So I would say that's the Salvation Army practice, but other organizations have different practices and policies that they use.
Tanya, would it be okay to possibly meet with Judy?
No, not at this moment, only because all of the agencies in Nebraska, except 3, myself, St. Vincent de Paul, and Sacred Hearts. We're the only 3 that help people. When we get funds, it's dispersed for utility restorations. Everybody else has adopted those disqualifiers. So it's created this whole community of poor people who have fallen through the gaps, and there is no help. There's no help. So I'm asking for you, for OPPD, work with us 3 agencies that give the money freely as it comes, the way it's supposed to be. We're not holding back on a percentage of our giving, our donated, our donations that help with restoring energy utilities. So, what I want you to understand is that this isn't happening. People aren't getting help when you shut them off. My phone is a hotline, 238-1221. It is so jam full of requests for help because I can't find anybody help for the last 2 weeks. I haven't been able to find help. I haven't even called into OPPD to talk to you because there is no funds to be helped for this community of people that have fallen through the gaps, and we need to fix that. They're your customers. They become my clients, but they are hurting and they're shut off.
I certainly appreciate your efforts. And I think, thank the Lord that we live in a community that the economy here is a little bit better than a lot of other parts of the country. We have electric rates that are certainly lower than the national average and lower, as we saw earlier, lower than the regional average as well. It's tough here for a lot of people. We understand that.
But again, thank the Lord that we're overall a little bit better shape around this part of the country than we are in a lot of parts.
I have to only agree with a little bit of that because, yeah, there's too many folks that are hurting. There's too many. And when you shut off people, they lose their food in the refrigerator. They're cold. Water freezes at 32 degrees. So this is, brings me to my next point. Thank you. So we need to fix that. We need to fix where your charitable dollars are supposed to be helping the community restore. Can we please look at that, what OPP is doing?
Is there any way of tracking to see that the money that, that we do give the various agencies for energy assistance comes back to the utility?
I appreciate that. Kind of a presentation on kind of where those energy assistance dollars comes to and the walk fund dollars that OPPD essentially initiated several years ago and how we distribute those dollars across the organization.
I appreciate that.
Mr. Chairman, just so you know, on the walk for warmth, the heat the streets, which we're a large participant in, Black Hills, MUD, so we are doing that. But this is good to know. We are trying to constantly improve how you distribute those funds. So this is good information. You should talk to Judy, though, and just kind of see where we're at, you know, Judy Martin. But
yeah, I know
we are doing a lot, and actually individual board members can help too. If you know someone who we could reach out to for donations and sponsors, you know, you guys can make a difference there, make some calls and do that. But we're trying to set a pretty good goal this year. And also what we're trying to do is an ongoing, where we get people to sign up year round on their bill, that we can replenish the fund. So,
but who has access to those funds?
Well, that's what we need to work on. You need to help us do that as well. We're always trying to, nothing's perfect and getting through the bureaucracy. You got a tough job.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. I don't mind. That's what my job is. But
you can help us improve it, is what I'm saying.
You have to be 65 and older to access those funds you're talking of, don't you?
No.
No.
That's a different program.
Oh, not LIEP. You're not talking about that.
I believe an LIEP is not age-driven. It's economic and income-driven.
Okay.
And that's through the Department of Health and Human Services, I believe.
Okay. All right. So I appreciate that, and I'll follow up with you and Judy about that. My second is a request to OPPD. Every year you all do mass shutoffs in the wintertime, whether it's January freezing or whether it's February freezing. So I'm challenging you and I'm asking you for your heart, OPPD. Can you please not do the mass shutoffs that you do every year? Don't do it for the winter of 2015. So many things have happened good this year for Nebraska. We're gonna raise the minimum wage, give people an opportunity to get on their feet this year. The shutoffs, I understand, cost you a loss of $1 million a year. Whether that's correct or not, I don't know. But somewhere, OPPD is losing a lot of money doing shutoffs.
Do you have a policy on shutoffs in the wintertime?
Yeah, we do. And typically, if the forecast represents days that are going to be below,
certain temperature,
we do not disconnect for that period of time. And typically, we look at over the holiday periods, we do not disconnect over those holiday periods, specifically the Christmas and New Year's holiday, and only at times where we know the forecast for multiple days will be at a certain temperature and above will we disconnect. So I don't think we do mass disconnections. It may seem like that when we get a period of time when people come off a summer bill. Now this year we're seeing kind of less calls on credit and payment problems because the summer was milder, as you heard Mr. Easterlin talk about it today. So we're seeing a little bit less of those concerns or issues. We did have, obviously, just because it's a summer period, we did do some disconnections and some taggings and a number of other different things like we would normally do, but that's year-round. We also don't do them during the summer when we know the temperature is going to be at extremes for multiple periods of time as well.
Well, I'm specifically talking about this time that's going to come up this winter, 2015, when you do mass shutoffs. And I call them mass shutoffs because my phone rings nonstop. Everybody gets shut off. If I can just get through this.
It indicates that on extremely cold days, shutoffs do not occur. We've addressed that issue, okay?
Okay, here's my, can I make my comment to you? All right. So will you please not do your annual massive shutoff for 2015, January and February, because when our winter weather does reach 22 or above for three consecutive days, on the fourth day, OPPD is allowed and able to shut off all of those who are behind on their bills. That's a true statement, correct, OPPD? That's true.
I believe that's correct.
Okay.
If the temperature for an extended period of time.
So 22 degrees is what we're looking at. Water freezes at 32 degrees, and so do your customers. So do we. We freeze at 32 degrees. So whoever came up with this magic number of 22 degrees is okay to freeze your customers.
And it's not 22.
It's above 22 degrees for three consecutive days, and on the fourth day, is that not correct? How's it work? Please. Correct me.
We will get you the specific information.
Well, I'm asking right now because it's three consecutive days, is what I was told by your staff, above 22 degrees. On the fourth day, OPPD shuts people off. And I've been shut off on that fourth day, so I know you do it. My request is that you not do it this year because instead work with the three agencies that give freely of the money that's donated to us, and we help those people specifically that fall through the gaps that aren't qualified enough for all of the rest of Nebraska's agencies that help utility assistance. That's my request to you. And it's your blessing that you're giving a gift to your customers. They're your customers. And if all we had to do instead of the shutoffs during that winter snap, when it gets warm for warmer than 22 degrees for a few days, is arrange special payment arrangements with the special extensions. Work with our agencies, and we will save the public all of those shutoffs. Because what happens to those families when you shut them off, OPPD? What happens to these families, excuse me, sir, I just want to finish one sentence. What happens to these families is that there's nowhere to go except to the homeless shelters. So then we've got homeless people who are already freezing. One already died last week on the streets. And we're going to put our OPPD customers in that same situation and use up all the homeless shelter resources. It's not right, OPPD. And I wish you would stop.
We've shown a commitment to work with the folks that need our help.
Sir.
We appreciate you coming down here.
Thank you.
Crystal.
Hi, I'm still Crystal Craig, and I still live in La Vista. You know, okay, I really have some pretty legitimate points to make. I'm having a hard time getting past you, Mr. Cavanaugh. You are very inappropriate. You cut me off, and you made a fool out of yourself at the last meeting I went to, and I am watching you patronize these people up here. These people come, they have not been here, they are all OPPD customers, and you are being patronizing and disrespectful, and I am ashamed!
Crystal, here. I hope I can sleep tonight. John?
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street. Well, we know what's happened to the weather. I didn't bicycle down here today. We had, for those of you who are engineers or like statistics, what's been pushing all the cold air out of Canada down into the U.S. is a 3-5 sigma high pressure area loft over Alaska. So when you have something that big and that fairly unusual, under 1% of the time you ought to get something that big. It pushes a bunch of cold air down into the U.S. Interestingly enough, because of the background warming up in the Arctic, the anomalies down here are more like 2.5-4 sigma, and we're not setting cold records. This pattern is going to continue approximately the next week to 10 days. The good news is that after that, we do get a break for a while. We have indications that the pattern is going to start to break down in about a week, and then there's a few-day response period before the cold air quits coming out of Canada in such amounts. The other piece is that this appears to be the development of a moderate El Nino out in the Pacific. When that happens, an interesting analogy is the winter of 1990 to 91, when we went into it with a more severe November than we've had this year. We had a snowstorm on Halloween. We had extreme cold in early November. Everybody was wondering what the rest of the winter was going to be like that year. And the answer that year was that every winter month was warmer than the one before, so that November was the coldest month of the winter in Omaha. This time, I can't promise you those kind of results. That was really unusual. But if we do develop this El Nino, it puts us back into neutral territory. What usually happens is that we get a split jet stream. That means two jet streams. One tends to run across the about the U.S.-Canadian border and helps keep the really cold air up in Canada, and the other tends to develop along the Gulf Coast. And in between many years, we are mild and dry when that happens. The trick is that that pattern doesn't persist all the time. And to me, the worst possibility is when those two jets phase. And when that happens, you get the cold air out of Canada, and you also get moisture coming up from the Gulf of Mexico, and then you get a large storm. Unpredictable. We don't have any good, reliable way of determining the frequency of those kind of breakdowns, so I'm not going to make a forecast on it. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Laverne Tran, still at 32nd Street. Just a little innovative way of maybe dealing with some of these shutoffs. You know, if you make a commitment November through March, let's just say, hypothetically, we will do no shutoffs. So if somebody doesn't pay their bill, you bankroll that, you put a little fee on it, interest, I don't know what's legal, you guys figure that out, too, because you'll have to maintenance it, and you'll have to, you know, it'll cost you some money to bankroll that. Then coming back in March, because I'm thinking about a carpenter who gets laid off, he doesn't not working in the winter, and, you know, it goes really cold, his insulation stops performing 32 degrees, you have a times four effect and when it gets down with the wind chills, with those bills going up. And then giving that person a chance to get back to work in March and April, and then start up a payment program to pay down those bits of money that they owe that you put a fee on because it costs you money to maintenance it. And that may be just a way of eliminating all shutoffs during the inclement weather system. I mean, it's nice that you don't shut it off during the holiday season, but, you know, Nebraska is a terribly cold place and very harsh. And so really you should just look at the whole harsh season, is what I would call it, versus the thing. And that's just kind of I don't know if that works for you guys or not, but that's just an innovative way of not getting people shut off in the middle of the winter. And then if you do want to shut them off, it's spring and they're not going to freeze to death. And if they do end up homeless, well, it's a lot warmer out and you won't feel nearly as bad as making them homeless. Anyway, thank you. Have a good day.
My name is Chanupa Gluhamani, and I'm with the Strongheart Civil Rights Movement in South Dakota. And I, too, am a Nebraska, you know, Public Power District customer from the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. Now, when I listen to everything that's being conducted, I have to thank the young lady, Crystal Craig, for inviting me to come down to one of your meetings, because I've been trying to get an insensitive with your other smaller corporations up there in the Panhandle, around Rushville, Chatterin, and so forth. What I see every time in regards to even, you know, my African sister that spoke about how are people being left out in the cold and so forth, these are truthful, you know, issues that need to be addressed. And if you make that attempt to try to stop me from talking, then I'll get real serious to really implement real policy and procedures about change of the economic system. Now, the public has never, ever, ever made an understanding to ask you to return all this alternative energy back to people that really deserve it. And we're talking about First Nations people. My land, my resources, and my water, and my animals have been affected by this, yet alone my own people. So when I hear this young lady here talk about how you're having a cost of energy that is sitting there freely, well, what's wrong with giving that back to the poor people and more of these native communities that need that? And we're all taxpayers, right or wrong. But every time we get into issues like this, We're always told that, hey, there's not enough time. Now, when you took my meter off, I also had to pay a reconnection fee. It frustrates me, man. We should be receiving electricity and any type of energy resources for free.
Who should pay for it?
Taxpayers again.
Taxpayers?
Yes.
We don't have any tax money.
Oh, come on, man. This story has been going on. It's been 515 years that we've been going bumping heads with you people, and not one man of color has ever turned white. Think about it. This is always what happens. And you think the good Lord is going to try to create electricity for everybody to use?
No.
That's impossible. So this is the reality. And if I offend you guys, what do you think you did to the rest of the community and the public? I'm part of the public. It should be a shame to everybody when you take livelihood from others. We haven't done nothing to you to take it from you, have we? Did we step back up and try to neutralize you when you create your power plants of nuclear, you know, waste and all this? No, I haven't. So why should I be affected by that when you constantly raise the kilowatts of the electricity? Give back. That's what she just said. It's just sitting there. If you can't sell it, then give it back to people that need it. And this is how you'll make this story this short. And I will continue to keep coming back because my reservation is affected by you Nebraskans.
I will stand by my earlier comment. If we can do our part.
John Atkinson, 4751 South 18th and Nebraska Wildlife. The website does look good, and of course it's nice to have those documents posted from Tuesday. That was very useful today. On the energy efficiency and the issues we've just been talking about, I hope there's a way to reach directly to the landlords who see no benefit to themselves whatsoever for doing energy efficiency. It's a tough nut to crack, but we got to crack it. And I hope you'll reach out to more than the usual contractors to do that, because that's a social issue as well as an economic and technical issue. And you know you have lots of people, you know, just waiting to help with that, including us. The couple of things have come to my attention. One is, and I'm sorry, Director Gay had to go because this was sort of a barb at him. You know, I've heard more than one person in the room say, well, why should we do anything about global warming because China's not doing anything and we'll just be at a competitive disadvantage and so forth and so on. Well, I think now's the time for us to step up and do what we need to do and make sure that the agreement we're just entering into with China, that they need to do what they're doing, but I don't think that excuse holds anymore. I think we need to get off the dime and do what we know we need to do as far as preventing the worst consequences of global warming. Also, I think, you know, we're rightly talking about the Southwest Power Pool and how well everything has functioned since March. I don't personally think that, you know, the penny price is necessarily the only thing we should be looking at. That's the simplicity side of that market. But it also proves that over a multi-state area, we can, in real time and in the real world, integrate multiple sources of generation, multiple sources of electricity, wind and solar and gas and coal, peaking plants and what we've been calling base load. So I think that's good, and I hope that lesson is taken and that we continue to see how to work that more positively, including maintaining that margin. So when somebody else's power plant goes out or one of our wind farm goes down for some unforeseeable reason, we do have that margin to back each other up. And it's that backing each other up theme that I think we need to pay a lot more attention to. You've heard me say in this venue before and others, that I think we're in for a rough ride. I think the University of Nebraska-Lincoln report on climate shows that most of us have been really underestimating the roughness of the ride we're in for. As I said, we're not going to flip a switch at 2040 or 2060, and all of a sudden the new normal will be what we experienced in 2012. That and many other things will be progressively happening to us. And one of the wonderful things about people here, just like everywhere else, is when there's an emergency and when there's a catastrophe, people chip in. OPPD employees go out there and do what they need to do. As Mr. Gates points out every time, when the rest of us would really rather stay home, and do stay home. I think that's true of our neighbors. If your neighbor's house is on fire, you go help. I think one of the things we've heard today is that we have many of our neighbors whose house is on fire in the metaphorical sense. And, you know, it puts a lot of us in a tough situation in this forum, because we want to be heard, we want our words to be considered, and I think to a degree they are. But I also have to be honest and agree that I do see a differentiation in how people are treated at this microphone. And it's very uncomfortable, and it is improper, and you know, I think it absolutely needs to be corrected. And that's just not something, you know, we can let go by. I think it needs to be taken really, really serious, and I think it will be. So I thank you.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no other speakers, the meeting's adjourned.